If you could tap into this feeling of love, like I feel so elevated right now. I feel high as fuck. Why? Because I am connecting to the spirit of love, to connection, and to the higher spirit that is the thing that connects us all. Life is all about relationships. Lovers, family, body, or money. How satisfied you are can be completely explained by how you relate to things around you. This is Sophie Jaffe, and together with my husband, Dr. Adi Jaffe, we are here to explore and teach you how to maximize your relationships and achieve a happier life. Let's get ignited.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to this episode of the Ignited Relationships Podcast. I'm Adi Jaffe.
And I'm Sophie Jaffe.
And we're here with a topic that apparently is bringing up a lot of stuff. So we're going to be talking about that. This is our Going Deep episode on spirituality. Weirdly, spirituality ended up happening in the shortest month of the year, which is kind of interesting because you guys got chipped out of, well, we gave you a Valentine's episode in the middle.
Yeah, the bonus episode. That was great. People loved that.
Yeah.
You guys loved that. Thanks for letting us know. I love that you practiced our journal prompts, and I love just getting your DMs and your emails, sharing your experience listening together.
Yeah, totally. And I just want to jump into this because there's a lot to talk about here when it comes to spirituality. So I want to, can we get a drum roll review, please? This week's review comes from T. Bearer. Thank you, little baby hearts. Thank you for the positive impact you've had on my life and personal relationships. I'm a therapist and working towards getting licensed as an LCSW, and your podcast has helped me and directly influenced my clients. Love you both, Sophie and Adi. Heart emoji.
Yay. Please DM us or email us, get a hold of us, and we will send you your care package since we read your quote online.
Yeah. And thank you so much. I always like hearing from professionals because, you know, some of the things we talk about are controversial, some are not. So thank you so much for letting me know what kind of impact that's had. That's amazing.
Awesome.
Now, Sophie's got a quote for us.
Okay. So in the spirit of spirituality, when we recognize our place in an immensity of light years, and in the passage of ages, when we grasp the intricacy, beauty, and subtlety of life, then that soaring feeling, that sense of elation and humility combined, is surely spiritual. Carl Sagan said that.
Wow. I love that quote, if for no other reason, the fact that that's actually how I got to understanding spirituality.
Mm.
So I want to start out with this just because you were kind of giving me a face when I was saying it before. So hopefully this will go over well, but this is a big topic for you to talk about.
Yeah. I've been in the spiritual world my entire life, but I've really started to embrace what spirituality means in the last like 20 years. And I think it's just a really daunting topic for me. Like, I've been in the yoga world and I've been around so many different practitioners and teachers. I've gone to, you know, silent meditations. I've gone to silent retreats. I've been in and out of different ways of practicing and what spirituality means to all these different teachers. We sat with Sean Korn, who's brilliant and amazing. I just personally feel like I am like the teeniest speck in a planet of...
Which is so fitting for the quote you just read.
Yeah.
But this is the first time I've ever seen you have imposter syndrome.
Yeah.
Well, maybe not the first time ever, but one of the first few times.
Yeah, I just feel, I like feel uncomfortable talking about it.
Like literally before we started talking about this, you said, I don't even know if we should be people to talk about this.
Yeah. I think I feel like I'm going to cry.
It's okay. I bawled my eyes out on that couch a few weeks ago.
Yeah, it's just like, I've been around such beautiful teachers and the way that they express this is so just such a beautiful testament to their life experience and to the work they've done. And I think I know that part of spirituality is digging into the work and it being ongoing and it always being coming back to the work within yourself. But it just feels this feels like something that I guess I just feel like I'm not an expert in it. And I know that that's the point. And we're just sharing our experience.
Sure.
And that's the beauty, is that people want to hear our experience in relation to different topics. But this one in particular, I felt, you know, super, like, I want to honor it and have reverence for it. And that's why when I came home from my flight last night, I was like, I don't feel comfortable doing that. And that's why when we had chaos in the house, I didn't feel comfortable doing it. I just feel like it deserves such a reverence and deep honoring and respect. And so I'm glad that we're doing it now. And I'm glad we carved out time. But I still have feelings come up around who am I to speak on this topic?
Sure. And I mean, again, that first of all, that speaks to that quote that you just read, right? Because it is when you recognize that you are but a speck, and the insanity of us even being in this place right now with all the improbability of that happening and all the other things in the universe that have had to happen over billions and billions of years for us to be here right now that allows us to have this conversation. But you are an expert on your experience of spirituality.
Right.
Maybe not on the universal experience of spirituality. And I think that's, you know, to me, it is such an individual experience.
Yeah.
I think we get lost when we try, like in so many other things in the world, to pretend like there's a version of it.
Absolutely not. Yeah. I mean, absolutely. I agree with you. And absolutely, there is no right way to do anything. There's no right way to be spiritual. There's no one way to have a connection with higher power or spirit. There's so many different ways. And I've experienced personally so many different connections to what that means for me. And I think separating religion from spirituality is huge also. And I think a lot of people connect the two and make them synonymous, and they're not, in my opinion. And I think when you and I met and I had to separate what religion and spirituality was, which I'm so grateful for, it helped me to see that spirituality is something within me, not something in something else.
Can you go in a little bit more deeply into that? So when you met me and you had to separate out what religion and spirituality
are. Yeah. So up until my late teens, I just assumed being spiritual was also being religious. And, you know, by honoring religious holidays, that was what being spiritual was. And then I found my own yoga practice and I started meditating, and I found God, spirit, higher power in my yoga practice. And that was, I was like 17, 18. And then you were Jewish and I was supposedly Christian, half Jewish. My dad's Jewish. My mom's Christian. And
I knew that, by the way, everybody did. She's not telling me that. She's telling you that.
And then, you know, I started questioning everything that made me who I was because you're Jewish and because...
I don't think I ever knew that.
Yeah. I mean, I think you and I met at a time when I was questioning everything anyway, about who I was and what made up my world and what, like... I think I always knew what my higher power was, and I found a way of being whole within myself because I moved around so much. So from third grade until college, I moved. I either went to a different school or lived in a different house every single year. And that forced me to find a sense of belonging within myself and a wholeness within myself.
Oh, that's interesting.
But I didn't ever have to say it out loud. And I think when I met you, so I kept finding a sense of self and finding a sense of who I was and a wholeness within myself as I moved from school to school, or home to home. And I learned not to define myself based on where I lived, who I was living with. Like, I started to separate.
But still on religion, because it was all Christian.
Well, none of that really matters. I'm just saying that I had to continuously keep finding who I was and find a sense of self in all these different houses and all of these different cities on the East Coast.
But how does that spiritual for
so
you?
Finding, figuring out who I was over and over again when I felt lost is spiritual, but I didn't realize that. I never had to articulate that out loud. And then I think it was really when I found the Four Agreements when I was 15 that I started to hear concepts that I had understood in my head on paper. And, you know, the power of manifestation, the power of our thoughts, and that, you know, what you can create anything you want based on your thoughts and how powerful we are innately. So all of those concepts were kind of like piling up in my brain and in my heart and in my being and continuing to lose my footing every time we'd move or I'd have to get new friends and then find my footing again within myself with not a lot of help from anybody else.
Right.
That was an internal spiritual process, was continuing to find that sense of self and figure out who I was in all these moments. And then I met you and you were Jewish and you started to question, like right away, you just had this like absoluteness of like, you must be Jewish if we're going to get married and have children. Like that was just like your baseline, which is so interesting because it's just not because I don't have that sense of religion within me and because I don't live by those types of rules, I would never have, you know, had that expectation for someone else, but you had this expectation in your heart, right? Like,
yeah, I mean, it's funny the rules that we decide to abide by, right? But yeah, I think it was always clear to me that my kids would be Jewish.
Isn't that a funny thing though?
Everything is funny though. All the freaking rules we follow are funny. Like, why do we decide to care about those rules and not these? Like when you say the word God, it grates on my soul.
Right. And it used to me, but now I've gotten through that after all my years of practicing.
But it's funny, like I don't have that same problem with spirit. I don't have that same problem with even higher power. And I'll explain my concept. But anyway, the point is, yes, that was a funny rule for me. And I still feel it, even though I understand that it's funny. It's weird. Life is weird that way.
Yeah. You know, when I was 20 years old and we met and you wanted to have children, particularly, like you knew before we even knew who we were, we felt the strength and the power of our love. And I think it freaked us out in some ways.
Didn't freak me out.
I mean,
I told you like on the fourth date or something.
Sure. You can be confident and say that now, but I think love makes us do crazy things. And I also think that I think it's crazy to, on one of our first dates, you share that you would be expecting me to convert and that you would expect to have Jewish children and that you would, and that you wanted children, like all the things that you said in the very beginning. I think that that's kind of crazy. Like it's beautiful, but it's also, it's kind of batshit too.
Sure.
That's what I mean.
It's not like telling you I'm an ex-con and I've been to jail on like date number half.
That was crazy too.
Is right. But I always, I mean, again, radical transparency, right? We've been getting close to practicing it from the beginning and I knew there were some rules. You're also right, right? You had like no buy-in. So you weren't yet bought into who I was to understand why you should care about that rule.
Right. And I was young. I was 8 years younger than you. And
You still are?
I was at a very different, I think late teens is a very, very different stage than almost 30.
Yeah.
You know, like the stages in life are very different as opposed to now where it's mid 30s, mid 40s. I think that's just like a completely different world.
I'm 43. Everybody not mid 40s. I'm early 40s.
I'm 35 and you're 43.
Early 40s.
Yes, yes. I think that that shook me to even imagine, like I was 20, I wasn't ready to talk about having children yet. And you were already in this state of mind because of how tied into, and it's so funny because you're not even a religious person, but you had this expectation. So at that moment, I was forced to figure out what religion meant to me. And how that tied into spirituality. And that is when I learned how to separate it, was at that moment of like, well, I'm going to ask you to let go of this part to you that you've been. I was like, wait, I have to let go of something that I don't even know what it means to me. Like, I don't even understand. You're asking me to give this thing up.
Well, I think this is a big conversation for a lot of people, because I think a lot of people tie religion and spirituality together. I think a lot of people assume they are one and the same.
Right.
Like, when I study the brain, reward and pleasure, we mostly consider them to be the same. Like, I like things that feel good is the way we think about it.
Right.
But liking and feeling good are two separate parts of the brain, and they can separate. They don't always do, but they're separate. The part of your brain that tells you you like something is not the same as the part of the brain that creates the pleasurable feeling in your body. And so what you're saying is there's a similar thing for you that happened with religion. And I think that's true for the vast majority of people. I think most people assume that religious practices is how you connect spiritually.
Yes. And so I had to question that. And it probably was like a solid 5 to 7 years of trying to figure out what that meant. And I was fine because I knew that I didn't grow up. It's not like I ever went to church. I didn't believe in Jesus Christ. I didn't have any sort of Christian faith in my bones, but I was being asked to give it up. So I had to figure out what that meant. And so a lot of feelings came up.
That's so interesting.
And for a few years, we didn't practice Christmas. We didn't have anything because that's what I thought I had to do. And I had to just like shove all these Christmassy Christian beliefs and understandings into a box and lock it up and then like throw it out a window. And that isn't what you were asking me to do. You wanted me to have Jewish children. And
yeah, that was like the only part that mattered to me.
But that's a it felt like a big ask.
I get it.
And what I realized over those 5 to 7 years is that it's spirituality is within me. It's not within a religion. Spirituality is within me. And I can access that whenever I want to and connect to that anytime I need to. And that by taking away what felt like taking away this thing that meant so much to me, quote unquote religion, quote unquote spirituality, by forcing me to look into what that meant, it allowed me to figure out that spirituality resides inside my body and inside my heart, inside my brain, inside my being, not in a book, not in an organized religion. And what I found is so much more spirituality by opening up the door to Judaism and by separating the two. And now the practices around holidays, even if they're Christian, like Christmas, are actually that much more fun because I've learned how to separate what spirituality is versus what these traditions are and what they mean.
Okay, so let's talk about the spiritual part, because I don't want to make this a discussion about religion.
For sure.
We can
sure.
get stuck in 14 hours of talking about religion. It's really interesting to hear how you got to that. And we had some amazing guests this month around that. What is spirituality to you?
I think spirituality to me is love. And it's love of others. It's connection. It's connection to every single living being on this planet and beyond. And it's energy. I think like it's energetic. Like it's an energetic connection that is whether they're alive in this moment or not.
I mean, you know, I always struggle with spirituality. I didn't like religion. When we first met, I said I was totally secular. So I also connected spirituality and religion.
Yeah.
I grew up in Israel. There is no separation of church and state in Israel. It's a Jewish country.
Which is so fascinating.
And so I've read the Bible, like the main Torah, which is the Old Testament, and then the five like other books 3 or 4 times over. Like I've read all of them. I know all the stories. I know really, really well. I just never believed any of it. It was like a story for me. Never talked to my parents about spirituality or religion at all. It wasn't until I was after jail, so like 28, when in the car sitting with my dad, I even brought up the topic because we'd never talked about it. So I used to think I was secular, and then I realized growing up in Israel that it just seeps into your bones. You can't be totally secular.
Correct.
Like even, I mean, maybe you can be an atheist like and go completely the other way, but it's almost like you get made to pick a camp in some way. So That's a long way of saying that for me, it was also very, very tied in. And I felt completely aspiritual, no spirituality whatsoever. And I probably was, and that was probably some of the reason why I had such a void for so long in my life. Like, the only emotions I was able to connect to were the negative ones, primarily because I noticed a void and I didn't know how to fill it. And I kept writing in songs and writing in poems and writing in general about there being no purpose. Mm. And it's why purpose and spirituality are so deeply tied to me, is when I started finding any sense of spirituality, it was really around purpose. And so for me, I would agree spirituality, love is definitely in there. And then potential. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of potential in the spirituality. And the reason I say that is I will never forget the moment I understood it for myself. And I was taking a jog. We were living in Doheny in Beverly Hills, and in that little two-bedroom old school apartment with the black and white checkered kitchen, like mm-hmm. 50s place,
yeah,
50s, 60s place. And I went for a jog. I used to run a lot in the mornings back then. And I ran by a school that was just a couple of blocks down the street from us. I'd run by that school dozens of times before. It wasn't like that school was unique, but kids were playing in the yard. And I remember having this little like moment of a download where I went, oh, like this school full of kids is a higher power.
Yeah.
I matter less than this school full of kids. Not that I don't matter, but there's like 400 or 500 kids in this school.
Exactly.
The potential they hold, the relationships they're going to create, the world that they're going to bring into existence by being is magnificent.
Yeah.
And it spoke exactly to that Carl Sagan quote that you read in the beginning, which is the moment you recognize how much of a speck you are.
Exactly.
Is the moment you go, oh. And it's not a bad, it wasn't a negative feeling at all. There was no part of me going like, oh shit, I don't matter. It was almost like the opposite. It was as if finally I went, I get it. Anywhere I look, there's more than me. Now, people have been saying that to me for years. You know, again, when I was in the program in AA, they were always talking about finding a higher power. One of the things I hated the most when they were like, you can pick a doorknob as your higher power. Placating the notion of a higher power to me cheapens it. But higher power is all around us.
Yes.
You know, it's not hard to see once you find it.
We each have a higher power, and it can be in, we can see it in things, we can see it in people, we can see it in experiences.
But to me, again, even the universe.
Yeah.
So, which is what I used to say all the time, and people were kind of like, didn't love that as an answer, but the universe, the enormity of the fact that we are a speck of sand, not even, we're a speck of sand on a speck of sand in this universe. It's magnificent when you think about it for a moment. And to just let that sink in, like Carl Sagan said, and that man has done some incredible stuff around the spirituality of science and the world that we are in. It landed. In a split second, it landed. And the moment it landed, it brought up something else for me, which has been the thing that I was already on path for, but I didn't have a name for it. And that was the singularity of purpose and impact for me.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, in finding spirituality, what I immediately connected to was purpose. Now I knew that service, that helping others, that making that magnificent world that I'm part of better than I'd found it is why I'm here. Because in the grand scheme of things, I don't really matter. And again, not in a bad way.
Right.
Like leaving my kids and the world around them better than I found it
exactly
is another purpose.
Yeah.
And so that's how I found it. And I had no connection. So that was when we were on Doheny 6 years ago.
More than that, probably. Yeah.
Six or seven years ago is when I first caught it. And ever since then, I have been trying to find ways to cultivate it in everything, in business, in our relationship, in parenting, in my relationships with other people, et cetera.
And that is what spirit is. I think it's trying to find what your version and what your definition is of a higher power, a higher spirit, something greater than what you are, like you said, with the children, like something that's more powerful than singly you.
And I think that might be, maybe we'll do like a little like specific takeaway for people in the end, but if you're struggling with this, then fuck everything else. Like forget all the rules that you heard this is supposed to be like. And then just take some moment.
Well, Sean Korn talked a lot about not having judgment and the importance of not judging and just meeting everyone with compassion and love and you doing the work.
But also meeting yourself with compassion. Sure. And love. So I wonder what it would be like for you to sit down, close your eyes and take a deep breath. And as you're breathing just in and out, just start thinking about what matters to you most in life. What are the things that are so important, that are so magnificent, that are so crucial to the reason why you see being here is important? And just let that wash over you.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't need to be more complicated than that, right? Like, if that's your kids, it's your kids. If it's your parents, it's your parents. If it's the reason you're here to make, you know, to end human suffering, whatever that is for you, I feel like when we connect to it,
yeah,
we get there.
And I think that we're all looking, or oftentimes when you are lost, you're looking for some sort of an awakening. It might not be a big, bad, bright awakening. It could just be in the simple moments, like Adi was saying, with like sitting and breathing and going outside and hearing the birds chirp and then feeling the wind on your skin. Like, it may just start there. It may not be a crazy awakening.
Sure. I know for myself, when I let everything else slip away and I sink into the actual feeling, even the little awakenings feel really good though.
Right. And I think just like the experience you're talking about right now, of you taking a jog and noticing the kids are a higher power, to someone might be like, oh, that's no big deal. I recognize that on every single day.
Totally.
You didn't have like the Messiah come down and like it wasn't some huge, you didn't see an angel in the distance or like your dead grandfather come and like tell you a message. Like it doesn't
happen. No, there's no burning bush.
It hit you and you were aware to it and you were open to it.
Yeah. Now here's... That's a really good point. There was no thunder. There was no like shifting of the earth. But I would say the biggest changes in my life have come from the tiniest shifts in perspective. We talked when you interviewed me about my story. We talked about the thing with my dad, the phone call with my dad. And I tell that story because I do these workshops online like once a week and I tell the story over and over and over, and it's still this one phone call with my dad when I realized that telling the truth and owning my fuck ups is one of the most important things I can do in life has to this moment remained one of the most important lessons I've ever learned.
Well, and if you break that down, you were less powerful than your errors. Like your errors took over your issues.
I gave power over to my mistakes.
You gave power away. Exactly.
Yeah.
You gave your power away, which is spiritual. It's just in, you know.
Well, it's the void of spirituality, yeah, right? It's the idea of I have to hide who I am because I'm less than.
And I think we find some of these bigger concepts in when it's missing. Like in the darkest depths of struggle are sometimes when we find spirituality.
Sure. And that's why I'm saying sometimes all we really need to do is give ourselves the space to connect. You know, I just got this message just yesterday from a woman who is hoping I'll connect with her husband because they've been struggling for like 4 years around some of the same things we talk about. And he's read the book and he's, you know, he's potentially ready to do work. And she doesn't know if it'll happen and all this backup story stuff. Mm-hmm. But at its core, I believe that for both of them, if they have this moment of really acknowledging, like, why are you here and why does this matter? If it sinks in, if it flips and the perspective aligns, then everything else you have to do is just the work. It's not that big a deal. It's not heavy. It's not hard to do.
Yep.
Like, you know, when we had our falling apart moment, like the last discovery, there was a shift. And sometimes, oftentimes, maybe even most of the time, that shift comes from pain,
right?
In some way. Like you have to get pushed so hard that you have to, it's almost like your brain then finally figures out how to put the puzzle together.
Right.
And in that moment when you did that and you discovered it and I just felt the ground dropping out from under me, I was willing to do anything.
Right.
And in that willing to do anything was some of the stuff that we no longer do because it's not serving us now, but going to more meetings, doing the more stuff, finding, reading the books and doing the support and going to therapy 3 to 4 days a week.
And
doing anything.
Doing the work.
Because the doing of the work stopped being a struggle.
Yeah. Yeah. And I also want to speak to something you said earlier about space and creating space. When you create space, that's when spirit will come. When you create space, that's when spirit will come. So in the morning hours, when your body maybe like wakes up for a moment, it's like 5 a.m. instead of grabbing your phone or grabbing an iPad or distracting yourself, just be open and receptive. When you are sitting and it's quiet and it's a perfect temperature outdoors and you close your eyes and breathe, allow that to be an opportunity for spirit to come. Allow that to be an opportunity for growth, for awareness, for a small awakening. And it's in those moments, instead of going to a distraction, you are at least creating the space for that energy to enter. And that's where you can then listen to your inner voice. That's where you can tap into your intuition. Being open to is spirituality. Being open.
Yeah, you know what I love about that? So like I said, I've read the Bible a lot. Like a lot. And I mentioned burning bush, like this idea of, if people don't know the story, you know, Moses, God spoke to him through a burning bush in the desert. He was like tending his flock and sees this bush that was burning on fire, but didn't burn. And God was speaking to him through that. And
like God was the bush?
Or God was the energy that was burning
the
up
fire.
The bush.
Okay.
You don't know the story?
No.
God, it's insane how many of these stories I have in my head. and it essentially told him, like, you've got to go, you've got work to do. You got to go rescue the Jews. And he was like, I don't want to. And the reason I'm even bringing it up is a lot of times this stuff doesn't come when you want it to.
Right.
It doesn't come when you're looking for it, which is really fucking frustrating.
Yeah.
Right. My mom used to have this saying when I was a kid. I just talked about it yesterday too. Whenever I'd look for something really, really hard, she'd say, just stop looking for it and it'll just show up.
Yeah.
But that's really hard.
Yeah. Well, like that right there is called trust. That's trust. And that is one of the biggest lessons you can learn in life. And that's something that like inherently I had to build over time was my trust muscle, because I kept leaving all of the things I knew. I'd have a wonderful group of friends and my mom would be like, we're leaving. My job sucks. I would feel lost in, you know, a new school or having to get a new room and lose all my stuff I loved, you know, everything that I knew that grounded me into who I was. And I had to trust that everything was going to be okay and that I could not just trust myself, but the world and my mom and this new life that was presented in front of me. Like I had to...
Were you able to even recognize that you had to trust back then?
No, but I'm saying I just did it. I just had to just figure it out. And I had to find that trust muscle within myself in order to find the little bits of joy and happiness.
Mm. I think for a lot of people, that strife, like, having difficulty in life on a regular basis is exactly the thing that makes them run away from spirituality, right? Makes them mistrust it. And that's where I think the religion / spirituality thing breaks down sometimes, is because it's hard to force this moment on people.
Right. Well, yeah, it's in the space where you're not looking for it.
Right. And so, I mean, that's a really weird conundrum. Like, how do you... I know it's changed my life. And... again, I don't follow a religion to this moment.
Right.
My spirituality literally comes in my impact and my helping for other people. That's, by the way, those of you listening, why I'm so connected and why we have a review of the week, et cetera, is like,
It's reminders of why.
Constant reminders that the work we're doing makes a difference, because that's why I do the work.
Right.
And
yeah, we are constantly seeking where we can go and be of service. So if we're not being of service and it's not being absorbed, then we're going to go somewhere else.
Yeah, which is, again, getting back to that trust thing that you try to teach me all the time. I still struggle with it, right? Yeah. Like I need, we talked in love languages, my thing is words of affirmations. Like I need some tangible evidence that what we do matters. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, and some of you listening right now might be in a place in your life where it doesn't feel like anything matters because it just sucks. And no matter what you do, it sucks. And everybody around you sucks. And you wake up in the morning going, today is going to be terrible and tomorrow is going to be terrible. And
I would say take baby steps.
Yeah.
Take baby steps.
And learn to trust.
One little step at a time and learn to trust your own inner sense of knowing, and that you may not wake up tomorrow in a way better, way different life, but you will eventually, if you keep making steps towards your own growth and being a better person, you will wake up soon feeling better about your life.
Yeah. And sometimes the way the world works and the way your life is going to pan out is you're going to move away from that discovery now. You're going to take care of yourself. You're going to do the things that you need to do in this moment to make life bearable or livable or okay or fabulous, whatever your specific situation is. And it will move you away so that you can have the space, so you can have the time, so you can have the presence to then have these amazing discoveries in your life. It's not linear. It's not.
No.
You don't go from place A to place B. Again, I'm going to go back to the story because I don't know why this Moses story is so present to me. But like when Moses saw that bush, he had already escaped Egypt. Mm-hmm. Like he got away. And that was the burden life, right? Like he was persecuted there and he got away. And now he's got this whole new life. And then God comes and goes, hey, by the way, you got to go back. They hate you over there, but you got to go back and rescue your people. We don't always ask for the lessons to come to us the way they did. When I got in my motorcycle accident.
Absolutely not. Yeah, say that again.
I was just saying, we don't always ask for the lessons to come the way that they do.
Exactly.
You know, but lessons come. Like breaking my leg in my motorcycle accident, one of the best things that ever happened to me.
Yeah. Would you have said that laying on the pavement?
No.
No. Would you have said that 6 months later in jail?
And if somebody would have asked me 3 minutes before it happened, hey, there's a motorcycle accident about to happen in 3 days. It's going to be in 3 minutes. It's going to be the best thing that ever happened to you. Do you want to still go that way or go the other way? I probably would have turned.
Yeah. And I think that that's the biggest thing is like we talk about healing not being linear. The same thing goes for spirituality. And they're one and the same, really. I mean, in spirituality, finding your intuition, learning lessons in life, it's not like taking 10 steps forward. You take 8 down this path and then you see something that throws you off. And so you turn to the left and you say, that feels a little bit better. And that's the universe is constantly throwing these tests in front of you and these opportunities for growth. Like the universe may send you a sign that says you have to walk 10 steps to the left. Okay, I'll walk 10 steps to the left because the universe told me to. Oh, 8 steps down the road, something shifted and changed and it feels different. I'm going to listen to that. The more that you hone that trust, that intuition, that inner wisdom and that inner knowing and that connection to something greater, whether it be your purpose or just the signs from the universe, if you're listening, that's how you know. And it doesn't always feel good. You might break your leg on a motorcycle accident, but guess what? Now you're sitting here with a PhD talking to thousands of people in your beautiful home with your wife and your family.
Yeah, and for sure, this wouldn't be my reality if that motorcycle accident didn't happen.
Absolutely.
There might have been another beautiful reality out there somewhere, I don't know, but this would 100% not have been it. And that's a really humbling thing. Back to that quote from Carl Sagan that you said in the beginning, that's a really humbling thing.
Yeah.
I used to say that I believe in probability and the universe. That's fucking magical.
Yeah. Like, all of it's magic. All of this that we're talking about is magic. And I think that's why it's so hard that's why I cried in the beginning is because it is so humbling. And it's like, I feel like I should be, I mean, I am on the ground right now, but I feel like I should be down on the ground kissing the earth, like that Rumi quote, you know, like kissing the earth letting all the beauty, like that perspective of life being beautiful is spirit.
Yeah, it's insane. I mean, even, and people talk about science as a religion at some point, but if you look, if what you believe in is science, and I believe in science and the sort of the physics and the chemistry and the that reality of what we live in, it is still fucking insane.
Yeah.
Like people talk about the billions of years that this universe existed. Like when I even try to think of that, really, remember before, like I said, take a break, take some space and close your eyes and think, that is, magic is not even a strong enough word for
it.
It's the notion that this world developed from these floating chemicals that then combined over billions of, like, what does that even mean? Billions of years to eventually create living molecules that were able to support life by themselves. And then all of a sudden those combined into like creatures that we've become over time. Now, by the way, I don't care if you believe in the creation story and a God created that, or you believe in just the evolutionary story and that's how this created. Either way, it's fucking insanity.
It's insanity.
And give yourself a little time with that before you rush to get your morning coffee to fill in the like the reports that your boss needs you to fill out. Yeah. Just like give that a
just
minute
sitting,
to sink in.
Sitting in that, whatever your belief is, even if it's neither of those things, the fact that you're sitting here alive,
like the number, the millions of things that have to go right in your body on a minute by minute basis.
Second by second.
To make sure that you can hear, just think about that for a second. We're speaking into a microphone, it records shit, yeah. It then goes, gets hosted somewhere, and you're listening to it in your car or on your headphones on the way to work.
And your heart's beating, and you're walking,
you're understanding,
or you're listening,
the words that
you're understanding,
saying.
And you're here, and you're with us in this moment.
And what's even more magical, you're connecting what we're saying to things that happened in your past that we don't even know about.
Yeah.
And it's making and connections to you because what we're saying is so universal.
Yeah.
If you give all of that 5 seconds to just really fucking sink in.
Yeah.
This is insanity.
That is spirit. That is spirit.
And so it doesn't.
And it can be, and that's why, like, when we defined it and I said love, like, this does feel like love to me because it is a universal known energy. Like, we all experience loving feelings and supportive, connected feelings when we are in this place of spirit.
And if all the people that were listening were doing that around the same time,
yeah,
there's hundreds or thousands in the same moment that are having this thought in completely separated places,
yeah,
in their own unique brains,
but
and
yet
got
it
here over time
us.
And we're all connected through this shared experience. And who the hell needs a bigger example of higher power than just us?
Yeah.
Not you individually, us, all of us,
the collective,
the collective,
yeah,
community. You know, it's, again, to me, it's mind-boggling. It's just insane. I studied neuroscience, and I still barely understand how I can speak and you can hear me.
Yeah.
It's just crazy.
It's amazing. I wanted to go back to the example of just like going down the path. And for anyone who's struggling, you know, it's not always going to be like an aha moment. And then like everything's beautiful. And then you wake up every single day and your perspective is that everything's beautiful. Like, no, it doesn't work like that. And for someone who is struggling and maybe you took the path and you listened to the steps and you took 10 steps in the left and you're going down the path and then you stop. Sometimes the lesson in higher power and sense of self is in listening and taking 2 steps to the other direction because the universe wants you to learn the lesson of no or learn the lesson of change. Oftentimes, it's about your ego. Oftentimes, it's about the separation. And the universe may be like the highest, best lesson for you in that moment may have been learning how to take a no and switch gears. Mm. It may be in, you know, helping us shave off our ego and attachment as a gift to a new experience. Like, that might be the gift. That might be the lesson in the path. And knowing that it's not always like take 10 steps and then there's going to be a light at the end. Well, no, part of being in your spiritual self is having enough wherewithal and awareness to let ego go. And say, like, actually, this other direction feels more aligned with my path.
Mm. Yeah, I almost think about it like water trickling, right? It's like water will find a way. It'll find a way to move.
Yeah.
If there's rock, it'll either seep in, it'll get into the cracks.
And just because it's not going that straight directive path, we don't judge water and say like, you're not focused enough.
Right. Get through the damn rock.
Yeah.
No, and if it's a rock that it can be penetrated through, then it'll sit there and it'll evaporate and it'll go find another route.
Yeah.
Like it's always,
it's magic.
It's going to keep moving. Yeah. And there's nothing you can do to stop it.
Yeah.
And you know, I think our lives are that if we stop resisting so much and try to make the lesson what we want it to be.
Right. And I think it's also about developing a new relationship with space and being quiet. And I'm in that place right now where I know from all the times I've spent alone, searching, struggling, I know that the magic comes when I am alone and when I allow there to be space and when I allow it to be quiet. So this point in my life right now, I'm really trying to carve out more space for quiet. Less work, less busy, less crowded around other human beings, unless it's my highest people, inner circle. Because that's when the magic happens and that's when spirit comes.
Yeah.
For me.
I love it. Okay. I feel like we've not exhausted. We can talk about this for hours, but I feel like we've given you guys a lot to think of. And so I really do challenge all of you. I said it in the middle, but I challenge all of you. If you're in a place right now where you can do it, you know, we're not up to an hour. You got like 10, 12 minutes before the hour ends that you've set aside.
I'm going to add on to your challenge. Grab a piece of paper and a pen.
Okay. So the first part is just be.
Close your eyes.
If you want to close your eyes, close your eyes. If you want to keep them open, keep them open. Your Derek always talks about keeping your eyes open because it keeps you in reality. Whatever feels to you like it allows you to connect,
yeah,
do that. Closing your eyes takes away some of the anxiety and stress that comes along from all the visual stimuli that you constantly get and your brain. You know, we're going to do an episode pretty quickly here. Your brain aligns with alpha waves, which are this kind of like heightened focus and not anxious energy. So if you do want to close your eyes, close your eyes. But this isn't about not thinking. This is an exercise that's going to be around thinking. So you're just going to regulate your breath and you're going to breathe in and out. And then as that happens, you're going to let either words pop in and literally almost like written words in front of your face with your eyes closed and nice big glowing letters or pictures or little movies of things that have happened in your past, things that matter, things you care about, things that resonate deeply, deeply with who you are and why you think this life is important. And I just want you to spend this time just thinking about that and letting each of those sink in. And when one of those images or one of those words becomes clear, just label it. Oh, this is me thinking about that place we went on vacation with my dad when we were young, or the love of my life, or, you know, any of these things that pop up and really feel and resonate for you. And give yourself a few minutes to keep doing that. And when you're done, and you're done doing the breathing and you open your eyes back up and you've had 5-10 minutes of thinking about this stuff, turn to that piece of paper and free flow write. No rules, no number of paragraphs, just what comes up. What is the feeling that you have? Describe it. Put pen to paper and really describe the state that you feel like you're in, the memories that came up, not just in descriptive terms alone. Get into the feelings. We're going to have a link to the feeling wheel here for you so you can have it.
Really, this is about holding space. It's holding space for something greater, even when it feels like you're doing something mundane. What is greater in this moment? What came through for you? Journal what came through for you in this moment. And yeah, take as long as you can. This is a practice that you know, when people talk about meditating and carving out space for self-care, like this is it.
Yeah.
If you can connect to this moment, to this exact experience that we are here sharing with you, this experience of love, if you can tap into this frequency and this vibration right here and now, as often as you need it, if it were just once a day, if you could tap into this feeling of love, like I feel so elevated right now. I feel high as fuck. Why? Because I am connecting to the spirit of love. to connection and to the higher spirit that is the thing that connects us all.
Yeah.
So if you can connect to this just even for 2 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, when you're needing it and when you're needing to fill up a little, do so. This is what it is. This is what it's all about.
Amen. All right.
Tag us. Let us know what you thought about this episode. Share what spirit means to you and what came through on this little exercise.
Absolutely. See, Sophie, it worked out.
Love you guys.
Love you all. See you next week.
Bye.
Thank you, everybody, for listening to the Ignited Podcast. We are so happy to have you along for this ride. Please go and subscribe to this. Leave us a review. We love hearing from you. And if you want more, don't forget to go to ignited.com, where all the podcast episodes are available with show notes and so many of the little details and links from each one of these interviews. And you can look at all the future events that we have going on, all the things that make Ignited so special, even beyond this recording. Again, thank you so much for joining us. We will see you next week.